Good morning and welcome to worship in Second Ballet Easton. Whether you're a member here, a visitor, or viewing online, we're pleased to have you as part of the service. At the close of worship, refreshments will be served in the church hall, courtesy of the Macaulay and Harkness families. Church House has indicated that previous COVID requirements have been downgraded to guidance and past decisions on how to proceed to the sessions. Whilst each individual is free to do what they wish, your session would like to continue with the present arrangements for a few more weeks till we see how the infection rate in the community changes. Of course, you would realise no one should attend if they have any symptoms. The sacrament of baptism will be observed at morning worship next week, Palm Sunday. In a further return to normal routines, the sacrament of the Lord's Supper will be observed at an 8 p.m. evening service on Maundy Thursday, and then again at morning worship on Easter Day. The Reach Out Committee will meet after next Sunday morning's service. This month's evening service will be postponed by a week until the Sunday after Easter, and will take the form of our service for our rural farming community. Contributions so far to the moderator's appeal for Ukraine amount to £1,650, for which we are very grateful, and there will be further opportunities to contribute. The PW will meet this month on Saturday the 30th of April at the Ross Park Hotel for afternoon tea at 2 o'clock. PW would like to invite members of Jewels and indeed any of the ladies of the congregation or their friends to join them there. There is a sheet in the vestibule allowing you to express an interest, or you can, of course, speak to Margaret Boyd afterwards in the church hall. The sympathy of the congregation is extended to Mrs. Helen Howey and her family following the death this morning of her father, Mr. Frank Michael Wayne. These are all the announcements.
Good morning, everyone. Again, as we move forward in the next few months, grateful for all the things that we're seeing that are changing. One of the principles we're keeping, just to reflect on what Robert said, at the heart of all that we do as a congregation is our requirement to love one another. So we're just asking that people be thoughtful in how we deal with the social situations we find ourselves in, that everyone can be protected and our lives continue to flourish, and to give thanks for all the good things we're seeing. And as you heard, Reach Out, our meeting next week, the rural service, all of these things are really positive to see, and we're very grateful for them. It's the fifth Sunday in Lent, and we remember and celebrate the good news of Jesus, who enjoyed time with friends, even with one who would betray him. And so we come as we are, full of our own faults and failings, yet each of us loved by God. Let us worship God.
Your love is amazing, steady and unchanging. Your love is a mountain, firm beneath my feet. Your love is a mystery, how you gently lift me. When I am surrounded, your love carries me. Hallelujah. Surprising, I can feel it rising, all the joy that's growing deep inside of me. And every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this God song rising up in me. Your love is is surprising. I can feel it rising. All the joy that's growing deep inside of me. And every time I see you, all your goodness shines through. I can feel this God song rising up in me.
Us pray. Loving God, thank you for being in our lives. Thank you for being with us in the good times and in the bad times, when we are happy and when we are sad.
Loving God, thank you for all that you have given us, for all the people you have sent to love and care for us, and for this wonderful planet that we call home.
Loving God, help us to be better friends, better family members, and better guardians of our world. This day and all the days of our lives. In Jesus' name we pray, who taught us to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
You all right? Sit beside sister. All right. I'm going to tell you a story today, okay? It's by a man called Greg Foley, and it's called, I'm going to find it here, it's about a little bear. And the story is, you're going to find out what it's called at the end. So you ready to hear a story? You do this? So, early one morning, a little bear found a box. He looked inside and said, why, it's the greatest thing ever. Mouse will love this. On his way to find Mouse, he showed it to the monkey. Monkey said, that's not great. He showed it to the owl. Owl said, I've seen those before. He showed it to the fox. Fox said, you're holding it the wrong way. And he showed it to the elephant. And the elephant said, I think it's too small. And he showed it to the squirrel. And squirrel said, I would be much better if you just gave it to me. And he tried to show it to Bunny, but Bunny said, I don't have time to look at it right now. And the little bear stopped. He wondered whether it was so great after all. While he was wondering, Mouse came along and asked Bear what he had. He put the box on the ground and showed it to Mouse. Mouse looked at it this way, and Mouse looked at it that way. Then Mouse crawled inside the empty box and said, it's the greatest thing ever. Thank you, Bear. Today, our Bible story is about a gift. It was a gift from Mary, a friend of Jesus, and she thought it was a wonderful gift, so she wanted to give it to her friend Jesus. But some of Jesus' friends didn't think so. Just like Bear with all the other animals, they thought it wasn't any good. They didn't like her gift, and Jesus' friends were angry. They told her off. They thought it was a silly gift. But do you know what? If you listen to the Bible story later, Jesus loved her gift. It was kind and generous. It was just perfect. Do you know, each of us has something to give to Jesus. We can give our time, we can give our money, we can give the things we're good at, like helping or being kind or sharing what we have, just like Bear did. But whatever you give,
Jesus will love it, because everyone has something to share.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong, they are weak, but He is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me.
From Paul's epistle to the Philippians. If someone else thinks they have reason to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, in regard to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, faultless. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of His resurrection and participation in His sufferings, becoming like Him in His death, and so, somehow, attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenwards in Christ Jesus. Thanks be to God.
A prayer of confession. Let us pray. Almighty God, Creator, Redeemer, Sustainer, we come this day to worship you and to ask for your guidance upon our lives. And we come to be still. We come to listen. We come to be together. And we come to offer ourselves to you. For when we have spoken without thinking, when we have harmed rather than healed, when we have excluded instead of welcomed, forgive us and hear our prayers, said and unsaid, in a moment of silence. We give thanks to God for all that we are, all that we have, and for the wisdom to pause and reflect in the hope that our words will bless the world around us this day and every day. Amen.
A reading from John's Gospel, Jesus anointed at Bethany. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, where Lazarus lived, whom Jesus had raised from the dead. Here a dinner was given in Jesus' honor. Martha served while Lazarus was among those reclining at the table. Then Mary took about half a liter of pure nard, an expensive perfume. She poured it on Jesus' feet and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, who was later to betray him, objected. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It was worth a year's wages. He did not say this because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. As keeper of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put into it. Leave her alone, Jesus replied. It was intended that she would save this perfume for the day of my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. Thanks be to God.
Trouble, you lift me up. call out to you.
It looks like our teenagers are going to be learning over the next few months what it was like to grow up in the 1970s. I can just imagine how many households now are going to be full of parents following their teenage children around, switching off all the lights. And if anybody dares go near the immersion heater, no way. On the 1st of April, when it's no joke to anyone, utility bills are skyrocketing across the British Isles and across Europe as well. It's a deeply worrying time for those who have to pay the household bills. And then we come to the gospel passage today, and this doesn't sound like it's any use to us whatsoever. It's a story of extravagance, and there's an accusation of waste in it. What does it relate, or how does it relate to us today? We're sitting listening to the news and the stories of things like pensioners are now visiting shopping centres just to get warm, that made the news yesterday. What does this story that we read of extravagance have for us today, of every age? It's a story that sounds in so many ways strange to us. The scene is this: Jesus is there at Bethany, before the Passover, he's visiting Lazarus and his household. And you may remember, Lazarus is famous for Jesus raising him from the dead. He had died, his sisters implored Jesus to help, and Christ raises him from the dead. And the result of that is that those in charge consider Jesus an even bigger threat now, and don't just want to kill him, but they want to kill Lazarus too because of the things that are going on. So here's Jesus with his closest friends, Lazarus, and the sisters there, and Mary comes into the room. No sense that she's expected to do this. And she anoints Jesus with what we call, it's called nard here, spikenard, one of the most expensive perfumes in the ancient world. Eye-wateringly expensive. And this is not just a dab behind the ears, it's all of it. And Judas objects. Why wasn't this perfume sold and the money given to the poor? It's worth a year's wages. With the news this week, it sounds as if Judas has a point. But in John's Gospel, there is something else going on here. It's a short story, but it's got grand themes. And you might not recognize it at first, but I'm pretty sure you know most of the stories linked into it. Because what is happening here stretches back through thousands of years of history. Because the people you anoint, well, they're monarchs. The kings of Israel are the ones who are anointed with precious oils, just like Mary is doing here. In fact, it's a strange story. And as Barbara Brown Taylor, who's an American preacher, points out, Mary here is almost, it's like a pantomime. She is acting out in an outrageous way in front of the men. A woman coming in and doing this, even to a close friend, would not have been on. She comes in to anoint him, and she's like one of the prophets of old in the Old Testament. Just as Samuel anointed David as a symbolize that he was king,
Here, Mary is coming in like a prophetess, affirming Christ's majesty. And it is weird, but the prophets were pretty weird in the Old Testament anyway. They went around, they'd eat scrolls, they'd cook food over dung, one of them ran around naked, they'd smash pots. Not terribly kind of conventional stuff. Mary's a prophet, and she is showing not just those closest to Jesus, but to all of us who read this story, of who Christ is. Judas objects. We're told, we're given an insight into his psychology and his mind. He turns out he's a bit of a thief in John's gospel as well, self-serving. But Christ rebukes him. And it is a complex story. There's so many layers and levels to it. But the only thing I want us to maybe reflect on today, in seeing who Christ is, in understanding his worth, because she anoints him, by the way, as well, with a sign of death. It's not the head that's anointed like you do with a king, it's the feet with what you do with a dead man. And she's doing this in the context, by the way, Lazarus has just been raised from the dead, nobody wants to talk about death. Mary, this is a bit of a buzzkill. But she's showing us what kind of king Christ is. A life so precious, that just like this really expensive perfume, it's going to be poured out extravagantly for the world. There's an extravagance here that Mary is acting out as a sign to us, because the John's Gospel is full of signs and miracles. It's a sign to us to see who Jesus is, just how special he is, and to invite a response. Mary's response to seeing who Jesus is, to seeing just what has happened, the life that she sees in him is God in action, and she can only respond with generosity. So maybe this complex little story that ties into thousands of years of history, maybe the only question simply for us today, in a world where people are scared and worried and tightening their belts and thinking about money, is, can we live with generosity? And part of that, to be able to answer yes to that, is to live lives of gratitude. Mary's generosity comes from the gratitude because of the grace she has seen in her own life, of how Jesus has treated her. If you want to continue to be generous in a world that needs generosity right now, you get to that generosity through gratitude. Gratitude to God for the blessings that we have. Gratitude to God for the many, many ways that we are so richly blessed because we have so much. So maybe the way to do that is, you quite often hear people talk about practice gratitude, in order to be generous, because that gratitude can set us free to give extravagantly. How can you be grateful this week? I don't know, it's going to be up to you. This is Lent, it's a time of reflection. And it's always been a time in the life of the church for Christians to reflect on their own personal lives and how we live. So maybe this week one of the things we can do is to practice gratitude. Because you yourself are the only person who can see the things to be grateful for. But pay attention to them. Because we can rush through life and we don't notice. Or worse, we can take things for granted. Look for those things that you're grateful for acts of kindness, for words of forgiveness, for somebody putting up with you, for some moment in your life when God has blessed you. Gratitude for family, for friends. I mean, we practiced it with the kids last Sunday, on Mothering Sunday. How many households had children tottering upstairs dangerously with cups of tea, a wonky flower, and some food that was cooked, perhaps, shall we say, with enthusiasm, if not skill. But the kids are grateful. And maybe the parents are grateful too. There are things to look out for every single day. Because if we practice that gratitude, it leads to generosity. Because you can be motivated by fear, you can be motivated by all the bad news, but if we train ourselves to not lose sight also of the things that we can be grateful for, then that gives us moments to be generous as well in response to that gratitude, which is why we have an offering, a simple, symbolic way in church each Sunday where we are grateful to God for all that we have, and so we share with generosity. So let us worship God with our offering.
Let us pray. We come before you, O God, with hope in our heart, with doubt in our minds, with love for you and your people. We come before you in dedication, offering what we have as a token of our commitment to your mission and message. Take them and use them. Loving God, you spoke love into this world. You called each of us by name to know you and be with you this day and forever. We give thanks today for the truth and the wisdom shown to us through the life of your Son, our Saviour Jesus. We bring our words of prayer for our troubled world, aching under the afflictions of disease, poverty, and war. Help us and all those with the power to do so to speak justice. Help us in your name to bring peace and understanding to all peoples. We bring our words of prayer for our country and communities. In this time of change and optimism amongst the uncertainty, help us and all those in positions of power, elected and unelected, to shine light into the darkness, hope into the helplessness, and let us who know your love bring it in word and deed to everyone we meet. We bring our words of prayer for your church as we seek to serve the communities around us. Help us to understand your love, use it and cherish it. As we dedicate ourselves once more to your message and mission, we bring our words of prayer for ourselves and all those we love, each with our own strengths and weaknesses, doubts and hopes. Help us to hear your word and use our words for the good of your kingdom, the joy of your people, and the glory of your name. In Jesus' name. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, through the fiercest trial heart's torn. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, sworn by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the love of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day.
As we go from here, may we act like Mary, and may we love like God, generously and extravagantly. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest and abide with each one of you, now and always. And all God's people said, Amen.
There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by dark.